Good morning, church, and welcome to our virtual church picnic and Pentecost service. Thanks be to God that we are not gathering outside on this particular day. I do hope you have a bulletin to follow along. If not, you can find one at our website, unionucc.com. I have some significant announcements today, so please stay with me. Julie Harder has one more session of her Seminary Secrets adult education program this coming week. She's focusing on biblical creation stories. Where are the truths? That'll be this Wednesday, June 3rd, either at 2 p.m. or 6:30 p.m. For more information, contact Julie at jblackharder@gmail.com. We do want to recognize all of our graduates, given that they've been deprived of an important rite of passage. So if you do have a graduate in your family, or if you know of someone who is graduating at any level who you would like us to recognize, please send that information to Eric at the church office. We'll also have a more formal recognition of graduates at our regular time in a June email and in a June service. We do hope you enjoy the service today with some fun built in. But we also want to acknowledge the grim milestone that we have passed as a nation, 100,000 deaths from COVID-19. We will ask God to help heal our land with a moment of silent mourning and to honor those who have died, often without their loved ones around them. By God's grace, we will mourn with families who have not been able to memorialize, to mourn, to even properly bury their dead. Our lament will also honor some hard truths we have learned during this pandemic. Our suffering has been unequal. Elders have been vulnerable and alone. Black and brown neighbors have borne disproportionately both the brunt of sickness and death and been on the front lines of fighting this disease. Native communities, our land's original caretakers, have been hit particularly hard, as they have been so many times in our past. Asian Americans have been targeted by hateful words and actions. Our prayers for the healing of this nation must acknowledge the brokenness of our democracy, and we must rededicate ourselves to repair the injustices this pandemic has revealed anew, even as we work for the healing of those who are afflicted with this virus. So let us take now a moment of silence to grieve, to cry if we must, and to commit to coming out of this crisis with a new commitment to justice and to solidarity. Please pray with me in silence. Amen. As I hope you heard from Pastor Bridget in her letter to the congregation on Wednesday, Common Ministry has come to the decision to continue worshiping online until at least Labor Day. Pastor Bridget's explanation of this decision is clear and compelling. I wholeheartedly support it. We are also working in a number of small groups to formulate policies based on best practices for when we do return to worship, for outside groups who use our building, and for future streaming of services. On some Sundays, we've had several hundred people viewing our services, so this is something we will want to continue, albeit in a different format. Also, don't forget the section in This Week at Union that we're calling Guided by Faith. If you have a story to share of how faith has mattered in your everyday life, please send us the story in a sentence or a few. See you again this week at Union for more details. Thanks to all of you who have been faithful and more in your giving to Union. Even though we continue to meet remotely, our church's ministries and financial commitments remain the same. Please consider making your offering online at unionucc.com or mail your offering to the church office at 716 South Madison Street, 54301. thank you again for your support. Now, please turn with me to your bulletins and join together in proclaiming the covenant we have made with one another, our bond of union. Giving our all as we have been given all, we accept the religion of love and service which Jesus lived and taught, and declare it our purpose to strive to do the will of God and to make the Christ Spirit dominant in our lives and in all human relations. Please now join me in our call to worship. Wherever the Spirit is, there is liberty. Wherever the Spirit is, there is patience. Wherever the Spirit is, there is love. Wherever the Spirit is, there is joy. Wherever the Spirit is, there is life. Wherever the Spirit is, there is peace. Amen. Please now join me in our gathering prayer. Gather us in, O God. Gather us from our scattered ways. Gather us from the highways and byways. Gather us from our vacations and vocations. Gather us in this community, united in light. Gather us through your grace. Gather us through the living Spirit who makes us one. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. And now, having passed out of the Easter season and into Pentecost, we join in an act of honesty in our prayer of confession. Please pray with me. Spirit of tenderness, we ask forgiveness from you and from this community. We have not always acted like the people of spirit, the people of love you call us to be. We have sometimes been impatient. We have sometimes been angry. We have sometimes been greedy. We have sometimes sanctioned or been complicit with violence in our communities and in our nation. We have sometimes turned a blind eye to the suffering of others. We are sorry for the ways we have harmed our neighbors and harmed ourselves. Renew us now to abundant life through your living Spirit. Restore your joy in us. And now we share in the assurance of God's never-ending pardon. God promises to renew us through the living Spirit, connecting us to life-giving people and life-giving communities like this one. God forgives all sins, and God will wipe away all tears from our eyes. Because we are saved by grace, and because we find strength in community, we are able to live fully and freely through Jesus Christ. Thank you, living and loving God, for the gift of forgiveness. Thank you for inspiring us once again to live with courage and conviction, free of all guilt and fear. Thank you for this day, for each breath, and for this community of forgiveness where we can start anew. Amen. Having gathered and claimed the Spirit's power to give us new life, we now share the peace of Jesus Christ with one another through whatever means at our disposal, text message, Facebook comment, etc. So, may the peace of Jesus Christ be with you.
Of the sun. Hi, this is Cheryl Myers, and this is my son, Nick Myers Olson, and he is going to help me show you a picnic game. We are sitting outside on our deck having our own little picnic. It's a beautiful, gorgeous, glorious day. We play this game often when we are in the car for long car trips or picnics, or when kids are sitting around and they're starting to get a little bored and silly. We have always had a lot of fun with this. I've played this with my kids and also with my grandkids, and it's called I'm Thinking of an Animal. So we'll start. Nick, I'm thinking of an animal, and it is white.
Is it an albino cat?
Good choice. No. I'm thinking of an animal, and it's white, and it's dangerous.
A white tiger?
That's an awesome guess, but no, it's not in the cat family. I'm thinking of an animal, and it's white, and it's dangerous, and it lives very far north.
Is it a polar bear?
You got it! So now it's Nick's turn, so that now he has to think of an animal, and I have to guess.
I'm thinking of an animal that is small but long.
Is it a ferret?
No. I'm thinking of an animal that is small and long, and it is brownish green.
Brownish green? Is it an earthworm?
No. I'm thinking of an animal that is small and long, and it shakes its tail at you when it's mad.
Oh my gosh, would that be a rattlesnake?
Why, yes!
All right, so that is our quick instruction of a summertime picnic game that you can play with your kids. Heck, adults can play it too. So thank you so much for being my able assistant, Nicholas.
You're welcome, Cheryl Myers.
All right, I'll talk to you all later.
The scripture reading this morning is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 through 21, and concerns the coming of the Holy Spirit. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly, from heaven, there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs. In our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I shall show portents in the heavens above, and signs on the earth below, blood, fire, and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Love is but a song to sing, fear's the way we die. You can make the mountains ring, make the angels cry. Though the bird is on the wing, and you may not know why. Everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Some may come and some may go, we shall surely pass. When the one that left us here returns for us at last, we are but a moment's light, fading in the grass. Come on, people now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, try to love one another right now. If you hear the song I sing, you will understand. You hold the key to love and fear, all in your trembling hand. Just one key unlocks them both, it's there at your command. Come on, people now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Come on, people now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, try to love one another right now, right now, right now, right now, right now.
I'd like to invite the children to come forward, to come closer for our time together. As you can see, I'm out in my garden. I was just doing some weeding. this is Pentecost, so I'm wearing red, which is the color of the Holy Spirit. And we begin with our centering prayer to the Holy Spirit. Please join me. Holy Spirit, bring us peace. Holy Spirit, bring us peace. Holy Spirit, bring us peace. So my garden, as you can see, is mostly in. A couple weeks ago, I showed you the tomato seeds, the tiny little seed. And now I can show you how they're doing. You see them? In the ground. Sorry, I'm a terrible photographer. But those are all the baby tomatoes. Those little seeds have now produced life. And eventually will produce food for us, which is amazing. An incredible miracle. In Pentecost, we celebrate how the Holy Spirit moves in surprising and unexpected ways. But it's also a joy when the living Spirit appears in ways that are promised. And Jesus promises to always be with us, to provide us with abundant life and any garden, even this little one, is a manifestation of the faithfulness of that promise. Would you please pray with me? Holy Spirit, you come to us in so many ways, and all of them rich with life. Wherever there is life, you are. We ask you to be with these children, strengthen them, give them life abundantly. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hear the Gospel according to St. John, the 7th chapter. On the last day of the festival, the great day, while Jesus was standing there, he cried out, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me, and let the one who believes in me drink. As the scripture has said, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water." Now he said this about the Spirit, which believers in him were to receive. For as yet there was no Spirit, because Jesus was not yet glorified. The Gospel of the Lord. Holy Spirit, rivers of living water. Please pray with me. Give us hearts flowing with living water, Lord. Waters that will quench our thirst, cool our overheated worries, and give us the abundant life promised by your Spirit. Amen. Can we take Jesus' words seriously? That he will give to us hearts flowing with living water? Why not? For our church picnic sermon this Sunday, I'm going to bring you some poetry about rivers of living water from various places in and around us. Rivers that can remind us how we're all connected through God's Spirit. Leonardo da Vinci, the famous artist and genius, put it like this: "In rivers, the water that you touch is the last of what has passed and the first of that which comes. So with present time." End quote. In other words, when we live in the moment, we can recognize that we are water, just like a river. 2/3 of our body is water. Anyway, and we can recognize when we live in the moment that this water is the last of what has passed and the first of that which comes. Every river connects. All waters flow together, even those within us. To the living Spirit, we are like any river, distinct, unique, irreplaceable. and at the same time truly one, united, flowing together. Norman McLean, the University of Chicago professor of English and author of the memoir, also a movie called A River Runs Through It, put it like this. Eventually, all things merge into one, and a river runs through it. The river was cut by the world's great flood and runs over rocks from the basement of time. On some of the rocks are timeless raindrops. Under the rocks are the words, and the words are theirs. I am haunted by waters. People everywhere have been haunted by waters throughout time. There are sacred rivers like the liquid Shakti, or female energy of the Ganges. Or there is the faithful wife Oya, otherwise known as the River Niger. There is New Zealand's Whanganui River, which is a living, breathing ancestor to the local Maori. In 2017, it became the first river in the world to be granted the same legal rights as a human being. There is the Urubamba in today's Peru, running past Machu Picchu, which the Incas thought was a direct reflection of the Milky Way, a celestial river known as Mayu, whose waters watered the sky. There is the Nile, the Amazon, and this river, the Pigeon. This water is sacred.
In Africa, Asia, the Americas, Europe, and the Middle East, I found stories of waters that preceded humans, preceded life, and from which life came. The Bible practically drips. Water or waters appear 694 times in 620 verses, as seas, rivers, and streams, and wells, cisterns, jars, bodies, and more. Creation begins in waters in the Bible, in both versions of the story, in a truth that transcends time. In the first creation story, in the book of Genesis, we hear about the boundless deep, the wild Tehom, upon which the Spirit of God moved. In the second creation story, there are four rivers that come together around the Garden of Delight, which is what Eden means. The rivers Pishon, Gihon, Tigris, and the Euphrates. Every river is different, but they all represent our biological origin and a sensual delight, a collective and personal Eden. I'm here at Haman Falls on the Embarrass River. The Embarrass is a tributary of the Wolf River. Its name was given to it by the French, for whom the word embarrassed doesn't mean I'm ashamed. It's a noun meaning obstacle. The river was, in the 17th century, and is today, often clogged with fallen logs or boulders. The power of this water is as impressive as it is beautiful. Right now it's flowing at over 1,000 cubic feet per second, according to American Whitewater. And that power of water in movement is why the prophet Amos used it as a metaphor for the way of Torah, the way of justice, which trumps, any pious and solemn assemblies we might imagine in this era of so-called sacrifice. So hear these words of Amos. I hate, I despise your festivals, says the Lord, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. This water is sacred. And it all comes back here for us, doesn't it? This water is sacred. We don't baptize as some sort of magic act to wash away sin, although there are Christians who think that way. We baptize as a reminder that God's grace is like water. It flows over and around and through, uniting us, strengthening us, giving us life. God's grace is like water. God's grace is in water. We drink water, wash with water, clean with water, bathe in water, swim in water, sweat water, are born in water. Water takes endless shapes and forms. As my mentor, Martin Marty, put it in a book on baptism, there is mist, dew, droplet, rain, torrent, rivulet, brook, creek, river, whirlpool. There is lake, and most of all, the boundless depths of the sea. Water produces power, cleanliness, life. It can be evaporated, frozen, changed. End quote. Water teems with energy. We baptize children because they are beloved. They represent new life. Children point us to the flow that comes after us. Or as Congregationalist minister Henry Ward Beecher put it in the 19th century, nearly 150 years ago, love is the river of life in the world. Through Jesus and the gift of the Spirit, God's creative and loving power brings us into community and washes us daily, each moment, for a new beginning. Forgiveness is as real as the water with which we wash every day. As we forgive others and wash away their sins with our own acts of love and mercy. To those who believe through the Spirit, God is a river of living water flowing through our hearts, carrying us all through whatever worries we have, wiping away our petty attachments, flowing with power toward justice. These rivers of living water, we might imagine, are the everlasting arms of a loving God. So, what have we to dread? What have we to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms. And all God's people say, Amen.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is secure from all alarms, leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, leaning secure from all alarms. Leaning, yes, I'm leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, Lord, I'm leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, yes, I'm leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Please pray with me. Living Spirit, spread your holiness around the world. Fill our lives with goodness, beauty, and truth. Help us to see you at work in the world. Rivers of living water that flow from our hearts and lead us into experiences of flourishing and flow, caught up in the river of love that is your will for all people. Living Spirit, help us to recognize your presence in our neighbors, in all of them, and especially in those we might consider our enemies. Bring us into touch with the river of compassion, the stream of mercy, the ocean of love that wraps us in your everlasting arms. Living Spirit, teach us the ways of justice. Help us to care for the earth, which groans and cries under its oppression. Help us to care for those on the margins of our society, the homeless, the hungry, the imprisoned, the abandoned. Give us hearts and teach us the ways to enact your justice in the world, in our city, in our community. Living Spirit, you bring life and healing wherever you are. We pray especially today for all in this time of isolation and for all as we reopen. For medical workers and first responders, for drivers and store clerks, for meat packers and civil servants, for those struggling financially and those who will struggle in the weeks to come, for those fearful and anxious, for decision makers, for all in assisted living or nursing homes and those who care for them. For all who have died from COVID-19, the over 100,000 in the U.S. and the 357,000 around the globe. For those who are sick and dying. For those who have recovered and are recovering. Bring families who grieve some comfort and help us to practice those measures we can to keep the most vulnerable among us safe, as Jesus teaches us. We pray especially today for the people of Minneapolis, the family of George Floyd, the family of Breonna Taylor, the family of Breonna Hill, and all who have been victims of police brutality. Commit us to work anew to end the scourge of racism in our country. For Bobby Mosby Johnson, who is struggling with health concerns, and for his husband, Dan, who cannot accompany him for tests. For Lisa Wozniak-Krieger, whose mom, June Dunlap, struggled with some health concerns but is recovering. Prayers for her continued recovery and safety. For Gloria Kamenacki's cousin, Dawn Baumgartner, who is undergoing chemotherapy after her cancer has metastasized. For Maya Zahn Ryan, her husband Tyson, and their family, as Tyson continues chemotherapy for Hodgkin's lymphoma. For Amy Klimek, as she awaits venous surgery. For Dar Saladino Blair, and all who struggle with memory loss or neurodegenerative disease. For Joanne Broski, and all who struggle with depression. And now, knowing your mercy and your power, we pray together the prayer that you taught us. God, who is our mother and our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. It's that time in the service when the ushers would come down the aisles and we would receive the weekly offering. Once again, as I emphasized at the outset of the service, even though we are meeting remotely, our church's financial commitments remain the same. Please consider making your offering online at unionucc.com. And thank you for your ongoing support. Please now pray with me our prayer of dedication. Living Spirit, we thank you for all good gifts that surround us, streams of living waters. Loving Spirit, we thank you for all good gifts that bring us life, our breath, the sun, summer breezes, songbirds, and the word of life that saves us from all fear. We now return a portion of these gifts back to you, and we offer these gifts to support this community. May all of the gifts you have given to us multiply and grow, so that the world will know more fully your just and loving ways. Amen.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the Word. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, strong in completeness where his feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden's a play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day.
Our benediction this Sunday is adapted from one used at Union Church, Seattle. Go forth, certain of this truth, this good news. You matter to God. Go forth with eyes to see those who need a hand and hear the good news. They matter to God. Go forth this weekend, dream dreams, pursue visions, and speak of God's goodness, using words as necessary. And may the God who breathed life into creation be your delight. May Christ Jesus give hope to your dreaming. And may the living Spirit, your advocate and supporter, flow down like a river of living waters with a passion for justice and peace. Amen.